within the autonomic nervous system. Autonomic nervous system is the last piece of the puzzle of the whole nervous system. We spend time talk about the central nervous system, including the brain, the spinal cord. Then we talk about the five senses, that's this. So the last part is this part, the belong to the motor output part. The motor output, or one you are familiar with, is the somatic output. It controls your skeletal muscle. And this is the one we're going to cover today. This is called the autonomic nervous system. It controls everything not under your voluntary control, like your pupil, your digestive system, your heart rate. It belongs to this. It can be divided into the sympathetic, parasympathetic. And these two systems are like yin and yang. Sympathetic, when it's been activated, if you want to use two words to explain this function, it's called the fight or flight. That's when you see a bear coming towards you, you quickly decide you want to fight or you want to run, and you need to run pretty fast, right? At least run faster than your friend, so you have a chance to survive. That's the sympathetic. The parasympathetic, two words to describe its function, is rest and digest. Apparently, your body could not 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, stay in the fighting mode. You're going to wear down. You need another one to balance. So that's the parasympathetic. Your digestive system, there's a big parasympathetic output. Your cranial nerve number 10, vagus, that's the nerve, mainly control all your digestive function. That's this. So if we say the sympathetic is for short-term survival, parasympathetic is for long-term survival, because eventually you still need to rest, you still need to digest, take the nutrients, and you need both. And both of them need to be balanced. When we look at the function that control the whole body, they control the whole body, both sympathetic and parasympathetic, most of the body parts, they're under both control. We've got a dual innervation. We'll talk about this term in the last of this lecture. Most of them are under both. A little bit of them is under one, like a blood vessel. It's only sympathetic, but most of them is under two. And it controls your whole body. So let's start from sympathetic. Sympathetic, anatomically, is some textbook call it thoracic and lumbar, because it comes from the thoracic and the lumbar area of your spinal cord, the middle part of the spinal cord. And it will control your whole body. So how do you remember their function? Let's say, use a scenario. Say you see a bear coming towards you, and you want to see the bear clearly, so you're gonna dilate the pupil. So sympathetic will dilate your pupil. And also, it will inhibit your saliva, because that's for long-term survival. So sometimes when people get nervous, they feel their mouth dry because they inhibit the saliva. The heart rate, the breathing rate, both increase, because their function is to bring the oxygen to your body, to every cells. So you want to increase both. Digestive system, all inhibit, because this is for long-term survival. Reproductive system, inhibit, because this is for long-term survival. So all this inhibit. Sweat, when you get nervous, you sweat. So this is one function, it will enhance sweating. So all based on all these functions, when it's been activated, well, that's for short-term survival. So when you are running away from the bear or a dinosaur, you're driving, we don't run away from the dinosaur, but when you're driving, actually your sympathetic system is activated, and you cannot control that. So if you like to eat and drive at the same time, chronically it's not beneficial to your digestive system, because when you're driving, you inhibit your digestive function. And this is interesting, let's look at this. Lie detector. The lie detector, it never tell this person is lying or telling the truth. All they record is the physiological response, sympathetic, because when people are lying, they tend to have more sympathetic response. And that's why we always need a subject, need a experimenter to analyze the subject's data. So we ask the subject sit here, we hook up a lot of electrode, measure their heart rate, measure their blood pressure, measure their skin conductivity. Why skin conductivity? Because when they're nervous, they sweat a lot. And the experimenter start to ask a lot of questions, like what's your name, what's your age, and have you been to Mount Everest? Some questions that pretty obviously no, that's yes, and others that's no. Now you have a baseline. When these people are telling the truth and when these people are lying, what's their physiological response? Especially after you ask 100, 200 questions. So you have very good baseline. Now they start to ask serious questions. Like, did you see this victim? Did you know him? Did you know her? Where were you when this murder event happened? And based on their physiological response, and this experimenter identified this person was telling the truth or lying. This is a lie detector. So lie detector measure the physiological response. Apparently some women can do this, right? They can look at the eyes of their boyfriend and say, where were you last night? And does this detect the physiological response. Pupil dilate when people are nervous. Now let's look at the parasympathetic. You found the innervate pretty much the same organ, the same body part. They just have the opposite response, the opposite effect. A parasympathetic, some textbook call it cervical and sacral. They start from the beginning and the end part of the spinal cord. The cervical is actually not cervical, it's cranial nerve. So cranial nerve number 3, 7, 9, 10, they're part of the parasympathetic. So let's look at the function. I still use the scenario to help you to remember their function. This is after you run away from the bear and you think, okay, what am I supposed to cook for dinner? So this system being activated. And they will constrict the pupil because you don't need that much light. And when you think about the food, you produce saliva. So the parasympathetic will enhance saliva production. Decrease the heart rate, decrease the breathing rate, because both of them are sympathetic function. Digestive, a big part of the parasympathetic. Cranial nerve number 10. That's the one will go to the digestive system, control all the digestive, because that's the long-term survival, and also enhance reproductive function. So that's how I memorize sympathetic and parasympathetic function. They're like yin and yang, and they're totally different. And they have the opposite control, and you need both. And this is system for long-term survival. Think about when you go on vacation. Some people, they say, well, I'm too nervous, I need a vacation. I need to slow down. And when you rest, you enjoy good food, or you do yoga. When you do yoga, the instructor will always ask you, slowly breathing in, slowly breathing out, then do the upward facing dog pose, right? It never asks you quickly breathing in, breathing out. Because all this, they are trying to enhance your parasympathetic function. And your life was too stressful because you had too much sympathetic. So they try to activate the parasympathetic. And both systems need to be balanced because sympathetic is for shortened survival. That's important. You see a bear, you need to quickly respond. But parasympathetic for long-term survival, you still need to digest. You still need to rest for your body to recover. So both of them are equally important. The autonomic nervous system, anatomical structure, before they reach the target, they always have two neurons before they reach the target. So that's the difference between the somatic motor and autonomic. They have two. So this part is called the ganglia. A cluster of neurons in the peripheral nervous system is called the ganglia. So they have the preganglia neuron, the postganglia neuron. And you need to know the neurotransmitter and receptor they use. And also preganglia, sympathetic, they tend to have a very short preganglia. In the previous few slides, you found that ganglia is right next to the spinal cord, the thoracic and lumbar area. And they have a very long postganglia, they're sympathetic. Parasympathetic, the opposite. They have very long preganglia and short postganglia. Sometimes the ganglia is in the target, like the heart. Parasympathetic output, their ganglia is in the heart. So they have a very short postganglia. And let's look at the spatial case. That's your adrenal gland. We talk about the adrenal cortex in the endocrine system because adrenal cortex, the outside part is a big target, big release for the steroid hormone. And now let's look at adrenal medulla. Adrenal medulla is part of the nervous system, it's part of the sympathetic. And similar structure you found in the pituitary gland, like the anterior pituitary gland is completely endocrine, the posterior pituitary gland is completely nervous tissue, and similar for the adrenal gland. So the inside part, adrenal medulla, is nervous system. It's a modified sympathetic ganglia. So when you see a bear coming towards you, you have an output will go to the adrenal medulla. Adrenal medulla release epinephrine and norepinephrine. Or if you are British, they call it adrenaline, noradrenaline. So epinephrine, norepinephrine, and it's mainly epinephrine. It will release to the blood, so it's like neural hormone, but usually people don't call it a neural hormone. When people say neural hormone, they mainly target to vasopressin oxytocin. And now this epinephrine and norepinephrine, they release to the blood. They will be carried by the blood to the whole body, and they're gonna target the heart, target the breathing respiratory pump, and make the energy available, lipolysis. They're gonna affect the whole body. So your whole body are ready for you to fight the bear. So that's the epinephrine. Because it's so powerful, and it can also quickly increase your blood pressure in EMS. EMT actually. And they in the EMS, they have a bottle of epinephrine. Because they need to make the patient be able to hang in there till they go to the emergency room. So they have a bottle of epinephrine. So when they found the patient's blood pressure keep dropping, they may not be able to make it, they're allowed to give the patient epinephrine. And when they inject the epinephrine into their blood, it quickly increase the heart rate, increase the blood pressure. It's like your sympathetic system is activated. Excuse me. And make the patient be able to hang in there till they go to the emergency room. So that's the epinephrine. It's mainly epinephrine, like 80% epinephrine, 20% norepinephrine. Now let's look at the receptor. Both sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system have two neurons reach the target, so they have a preganglia and postganglia. Sympathetic preganglia neuron release acetylcholine, and they bind with nicotinic acetylcholine receptor. It's an ion channel. The postganglia release norepinephrine. They bind with adrenergic receptor. So we have five different adrenergic receptors, alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3. We'll talk about them today. Parasympathetic preganglia release acetylcholine, bind with nicotinic acetylcholine receptor. And you say, will they be confused? No, because they have different ganglia, so it's not a problem. In the postganglia part, you say, well, the target are all the same. How do they know it's sympathetic and parasympathetic? Because the parasympathetic use different neurotransmitter, acetylcholine as well. And this time they bind with muscarinic acetylcholine receptor. Muscarinic acetylcholine receptor is a G protein coupled receptor. So it will activate G protein and trigger the signal transduction. So say even though it's the heart and they receive dual innervation, both sympathetic and parasympathetic, if it's norepinephrine, they know, oh, that's the sympathetic, I supposed to increase the heart rate. And if it's acetylcholine, the heart knows, okay, that's the parasympathetic, I will decrease the heart rate. So it's based on the neurotransmitter and the receptor. Nicotinic acetylcholine receptor is an ion channel, and the muscarinic nicotinic acetylcholine receptor is first identified in tobacco cell. That's why I call it nicotinic. And muscarinic acetylcholine receptor is first identified in mushroom. So that's muscarinic. Okay, let's take a break.